If the Bible, which has been given to us as a point of reference, which Jesus said is God's truth, then why are there so many different interpretations of this truth, which has resulted in many various different sects, such as Catholicism, baptism?
Last night, this question came in a bit of a different form, so if there's a little bit of repetition, allow me to make that. Christianity is not the only faith or the religious worldview that has various groups. The Muslims have it, the Buddhists have it, the Hindus have it, the Sikhs have various sects within their own group, and every group has its sects. So what happens is, in the Christian faith, the reason the Bible was even formed, by the way, and the canon was pulled together, was because there were those who were trying to bring in heretical views and contrary views to what it is that Christ actually taught. And that, of course, continues to this very day. Now, when the Bible was collected, you've got to look at it. It is a very different form of scripture to anything else. For example, the Quran claims to be singularly revealed, verbally dictated. Every word remains unchanged. So the assertion is. And it comes across from the 6th century and so on. That's why even translations are never treated on the same level as the original in the Arabic that is given, and the most sacred text preserved by them. The Bible is written across 1400 years. Moses lives around 1450 before Christ, so you take his writings, and then you come to the time of the kings and the judges and the prophets, and then you have the break, and John the Baptist comes in to announce the coming of Jesus Christ. When you look across 1500 years of prophecy, the first thing that arrests you is the spectacular way in which there is a single thread from beginning to end. From the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation, the focus is the person of Jesus Christ. The place of his birth is given centuries before. The name is given long before. His ministry is given long before. His death is predicted 700 to 800 years before. The kind of specific prophecy, for example, is given to us in a book of Daniel. Daniel, writing in the late 500s, talks about a massive emperor. It's talking about Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian emperor. He says he will suddenly be cut down. Then he goes into the Medo-Persian and on and on. He goes all the way to the time of Alexander the Great, who also, he says, as a young man, his life will be snuffed out. Empire divided into four, four blend into two, two emerge into one. When you look at history from Alexander the Great to the four Macedonia, to the four generals, to the Ptolemy, to the Seleucid, to the Roman Empire, you see it as specific prophecy given centuries before. So the first thing you hear is, this is a supernatural book. It is not merely talking about an idea. There is a supernatural element to it. Now, when Jesus' birth is predicted, his death is predicted, and his resurrection is predicted, and the message is compiled in one Holy Bible, as it were, people across centuries will read it, and human tendency being what it is. Somebody once said, when the flood tides are low, every shrimp has its own puddle. And everybody wants to have his own little group, you know. So here comes one denomination, another denomination, another denomination. One person says you've got to go under the water if you're really going to be baptized. Another one says you're going to go right to the top of the head. Just the sprinkling, it doesn't matter what else you do. And, you know, you go through all of these various debates to the true follower of the Bible. It becomes an important issue that they're believing it the way it is presented. My answer to you is this. Unity of belief does not always mean uniformity of expression. I believe there are some who may take one aspect of the Bible and make that more major than, say, I would make it. The most important thing I would say to you is that we need to measure the interpretation by the facts of the text that they are interpreting. That's how you check it out against the referent. Now, the Bible is a unique book, you know. We don't have one statement extant ever written to us by Socrates. We think he said all those things because Plato tells us that. The difference between what Homer wrote and the first extant copy is over 1,000 years. The Bible is the lone document that we have, where within a century of its articulation of these major truths, we have extant copies, and by the first 300 years, we have a complete corpus of material of the Old and the New Testament. So the problem is not with the scriptures. The problem is the way people sometimes interpret it, and you have to check the referent then and make sure that that interpretation is valid. Once you have checked against the referent, you're able to talk to the person about whether it's a legitimate interpretation or an illegitimate interpretation. We should not fault the source because of the way it is used or abused. And the most important doctrines are clearly understood by the believers. In terms of the Protestant and the Roman Catholic division, which is a very great and a very tremendous historic division, and since you mentioned it, I should address that. And by the way, again, I've spoken in both categories of universities and seminaries and so on. What was the difference? The difference came in that in the Catholic Church, the authority was the Church. Whether it be the Pope or the priesthood or the cardinals, whoever, the authority was the Church. The Church had the right to interpret the Scriptures, and the Church interpreted it, and this is the way it is interpreted. When Martin Luther came on the scene in the 1500s, Martin Luther was not a bad Catholic, he was a good one. He found out he was not having ease with his conscience. He wanted to keep on confessing because he would go to bed and suddenly remember something else. And as he was reading the Scriptures, he noticed in the book of Romans that the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. What he did was not destroy the priesthood in the Catholic Church. He said, every Christian is a priest before God. I have a right to come before God directly. So in the Protestant Church, the cry was sola scriptura, the Scriptures alone. Sola fide, by faith alone. So it is a question of the repository of authority. In the Catholic Church, they went with the papacy and the Church. In the Protestant Church, they went with the final authority of the Scriptures and the priesthood of the believer. Now, your challenge should be to look into the Bible and see which of these two schools of thoughts is in keeping with the Scriptures. And that's how you find out where the truth is.